Good evening from Istanbul. Welcome to the Library Talks. This is an event jointly organized by the Library of the Research Center for Anatolian Civilizations at Koç University and the History Foundation in Turkey. This month's speakers are Evangelia Balta from the National Hellenic Research Foundation and Sada Payer from the University of Oxford. I would like to welcome them both. Thank you for accepting our invitation and for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you. The title of the talk is The Transfer of Greek Fiction to Ottoman Literature via the Karamanlides. Our speakers will discuss a 19th century novel, Beyoğlu Sırları, Mysteries of Pera by Epaminondas Kyriakides, and more particularly its Karamanlidika translation, which was republished last year by İstos in Istanbul. Before we proceed, I would like to introduce the speakers. Evangelia Balta is Research Director at the Institute of Historical Research, National Hellenic Research Foundation in Athens. Her research work includes studies and books on the economic and social history and culture of the Ottoman Empire. Since 1979, she has been interested in the history and culture of the Turkish-speaking Orthodox Christians of Anatolia. An honorary member of the Turkish Historical Society, she was awarded the Order of Merit Medal. Further information about her academic work can be found at her website, evangeliabalta.com. Sada Payer is a PhD candidate in history in the Faculty of Oriental Studies at the University of Oxford. Her dissertation inquires into entertainment practices in late Ottoman Istanbul and focuses on transgressions involving Greek Orthodox Christians, transgressions which were regarded as such by their ethno-religious community, the Ottoman state, and the wider population of the capital. Sada Payer will also moderate today's talk. And before I leave the floor to the speakers, let me give some technical information to our viewers about this talk. This session is recorded and will later be shared on the SoundCloud and YouTube channels of Anamet. The talk will last for about an hour, and then we will proceed with a Q&A session. Microphones and videos are off and will remain off during the session. You as viewers can use the chat function at the bottom of the Zoom page to write your questions and comments. And now I leave the floor to Evangelia Balta. Evangelia Hocam, buyurun.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ayşem. Hello and welcome to all those viewing and listening to our speech. I wish you all health and joy. I hope that it will not be long before we can all meet again in classrooms, libraries, restaurants, coffee shops, theaters, cinemas, etc. I hope that we will find our everyday life in the past years soon. In addition to the thank you for the invitation ritual with which the speaker usually begins his speech, allow me to confess how uncomfortable I feel speaking in front of a screen without any visual or auditory contact with my audience. There is no way of knowing how my lecture is being received by the audience's participation, and it is tough to achieve a dialogue through chats. There is no discussion, simply the speaker gives another lecture ex cathedra on a subject posed by a selected question or a group of questions. Nothing as an exchange of opinions. So please allow me not to take part in the chat process. I will try to make my speech as detailed as possible, and I hope I can do this adequately. I must confess, though, that I am very sorry to miss the opportunity to have a real discussion with you on matters concerning the research that Sadap Air and I have presented in our book. I firmly believe that the writer has a lot to gain by conversing with his audience, especially when this is also his reading public. So I will make a proposition. If you have a particular issue to discuss with me, not only on the subject of this lecture, but generally on Karamanlidis studies, please send me a message in my email. Please, a short mail. Be sure that you will receive an answer. And now, let's work. I will divide in two parts my speech. Before speaking about the Karamanlidika translations of the Greek novels, using the example of the serialized novel Beoglou Sirlar, I will touch on the prehistory of my involvement with the study of the Karamanlidika book production. I think that this tour d'horizon will make clear why I became involved in publishing this novel and some others during these last years. At the same time, my itinerary in the paths of Karamanlidika issues may give you the line to follow the development of this utterly neglected field of Ottoman studies, which now became a la mode. I started studying Karamanlidika issues in 1978 as a young scholar in the Center for Asia Minor Studies. It began from my interest in Karamanlidika books because I believe that they are until the best field to explore aspects of the cultural identity of the Turkish-speaking Orthodox populations of Anatolia. Very early, I had turned my back to the discussions on the origin of the Turkish-speaking Orthodox because they were and they continue to be unsought. Why? Because there is no evidence for the pre-Ottoman period to explore the issue with a historical approach. We don't have any historical documentation from the late 11th to late 15th century. The only thing left for a historian to investigate was the timing and circumstances under which arose the origin of Karamanlis and to analyze the arguments used by the Turkish and Greek sides. As my interest focused on the Karamanlidika printed matter, it was necessary, first of all, to gather together the production that had remained uncatalogued following the death of the two pioneers Catholics, Severien Salaville and Evzen D'Alesio. I tried to fill the gaps, hoping to complete the work, but this kind of work never has an end. I published three volumes of addenda, and I continue to work on the supplemented, revised reprint of the Karamanlidika bibliography. Having monitored this production, I had attested that Karamalidika publications, both religious and lay, secular, are nothing but translations. Few titles fall into the category of rewriting texts. Therefore, Karamalidika editions provided an excellent field for studying cultural transfer. And the study of cultural transfer necessitated a search within a historical setting for links between Karamalidika printed matter and the Ottoman and Greek world. And of course, the most favored and exciting subject was the novel. The transcription of the Masai Dunya in 1986 by Robert Anenger and Vedat Gunyol opened the chapter Karamalidika novel. And it is not fortuitous that his close friend Andreas Tietze released in the same period the Turkish-Armenian story Agapi Hikayesi. They are the pioneers. Anenger and Tietze first introduced in the Ottoman literature Turkish literary texts written in Greek and Armenian alphabets. Noricinde Yatsin. And I feel fortunate because I met them and I had the opportunity to have with them long discussions on Karamalidika and Armeno-Turkish literature during the summers when I was coming from Athens to work in the Başbakanlık Arşivi. I am very grateful to them because they helped me to control my ideas on this subject. When I published the Karamalidika bibliography, I was only 32 years old and I was alone in Greece. So in Istanbul, I found a team to exchange my opinions, to control me. Just before a year, the Masai Dunya appeared and papers of by Anenger and studies, interest studies in the periodical Tarikh ve Toplum. Turgut Kut followed his path also working on Karamalidika and Armeno-Turkish literature. In the following years, they started to appear some other interesting studies. Johann Strauss argued in many, many cases that the ethno-religious communities of the Ottoman Empire borrow literary texts from one another rather than translating them from the original language. He gave excellent examples from the novels. Ioanna Petropoulou from the Center for Asia Minor Studies in Athens referred to the dissemination of Karamalidika translated novels among Turkish-speaking Orthodox and presented accounts from the Archive of Oral History at our center. Gunul Özlem Çepe and Etienne Charrier in their doctoral thesis did numerous references to Karamalidika editions of novels. Therefore, when studying the case of Karamalidika novels, we also inevitably explore the field of translations. This topic, over the last two decades, has become to excite the interest of Ottoman studies. There are many, as you can see, many doctoral theses on the Turkish translations from the West novels, etc. So, all these years, I proposed to colleagues who wanted to work on Karamanlidis studies to be oriented to this sector. Some case studies were presented in our workshops or included in the volumes concerned the Karamanlidis studies. For example, Anthikara described the connection between polypathies by Istanbuliot Grigorios Paleologou and Evangelinos Misailidis Temasai Dunia. Aileen de Tapia published a study on the Karamanlidis versions of La Portée du Pain by Xavier de Montepin. She compared the original French version with the translated versions in the Greek and Karamanlidis editions, with excellent and very interesting observations. Senasis Manoglou gave a paper for the novels published as Phaigeton in Anatolie of Evangelinos Misailidis, and her thesis was dedicated to Temasai Dunia. She also presented Beoglou Sirlarou in a workshop in Komotini. Accumulating the titles of the novels released as books or as feuilletons in Karamanlidis newspapers and periodicals survived, because we don't have the totality of this material, we can attest that very few Greek literary texts were translated into Karamanlidis. In contrast to Turkish Armenian literature, because there are many translations of Armenian works. As a historian of the Ottoman era, I thought it is a great significance to study all those Greek texts passed into the Turkish language via the Karamanlidis text. They consist as a part of the corpus of Ottoman literature as the translations of the 19th century Western novels released in Arabic script. Permit me to give you an example. A study on the Karamanlidis editions of Aesop's fable completed a few years ago in collaboration with postgraduate students at the Intensive Summer School of Ottoman Studies in Zunda, showed that Aesop's fables entered Ottoman literature for the first time through the Karamanlidis edition of 1854. Rahmetli Anenger noted it since the 50s, presenting a Karamanli manuscript of Aesop's fables from Crimea. This Karamanlidis manuscripts discovered by Otto Blau, an excellent philologist. We have not yet studied such topics systematically, and it is essential for the history of Ottoman literature. We don't see perhaps much interest, probably because the research of this kind requires proficiency in languages, knowledge of foreign literature, and hard work. They ask also for collaborations because they have to do with the field of comparative studies. So I found it helpful to create a project focused on the Karamanlidika translations from the Greek literary texts and invited some colleagues to participate. In this frame, we published the Karamanlidika translation of Notary of Alexandros Rizos Raggavis, an Istanbuliot, the Aesop's Fables, added the Ottoman Aesop's Vida by Ebu Zouya Mehmet Tefik, The Mysteries of Pera by Epaminondas Kyriakidis. Stavros Anestidis presented the novel Bir Valide by Spiridon Vasiliadis, and he showed that Vasiliadis based on the homonymous work of Hans Christian Andersen. In a very new two-volume work published by the Department of Harvard, of Turkish Studies of Harvard University, Willy Strober presented the Karamanli Turkish translation of Aristoteles Valaoritis' poem Thanasis Vayas. Anastasia Tsapanidou, a prof in the University of Komotini, compared the Karamanlidika text of Abraham Kurbana with the Greek original. And with the collaboration of Murat Demir, a student of Koç University, we will publish the novel Protaprilia, the 1st of April, by the son of Misailidis, Christophoros, also presented a serialized novel in the newspaper Anatoly. This project aims to publish an annotated edition of translated Greek novels circulated in Karamanlidika newspapers and periodicals from the second half of the 19th century onwards. We think that this procedure contributes to their integration into Ottoman literary production. As an archaeologist would do, we bring to the surface a monument of a civilization that no longer exists. These Karamanlidika translations belong to historical research. Some people naively reject these translations based in their dated Turkish language. They forget that these translations are a social and cultural phenomenon, witnesses to multiple relationships between cultures, evidence of the Turkish language spoken by the Turkish-speaking Orthodox of the Ottoman Empire. At the same time, this translation constitute per se evidence of literature. In most cases, translators intervene in various ways in the source text, thus creating their own literary text for their readers, that means for the Turkish-speaking Anatolians. I stopped here this introductory speech by handing it over to Sada Pair. She will present the story of the novel Beoglu Sirlar, and especially her work to transcribe the Turkish text of the novel written in in Greek characters into the Latin alphabet. Mm-hmm. An undertaking that may seem to many to be easy, automated. But it is not like that at all. A great deal of hard work is needed. Knowledge is required, research, so that the Karamanlidika text is not lost, does not lost the peculiarities of the language, all those characteristics of its identity that is the room, culture. In other words, the text's historicity must be preserved, but without it ceasing to be an interesting text for the academy and at the same time an attractive text for today's reader of novels. I would like to say a big thank you today to hardworking Sada, who agreed to join forces with me in the complex and time-consuming, but yet fascinating work required by this book. Sadam Siran.
Thank you, Dr. Balta. It's an honor, such a great pleasure to hear this from you. So let me give some background information and just a little bit of information on the story. So the novel on which we are talking today is the translation of Peran Apokrypha, a Greek novel in the category of city mysteries, which began to be published as a serial in Greek in the Constantinopolitan newspaper Epitheorisis by Epaminondas Kyriakidis, almost about a month before its translation, Beyoğlu Sırları, by Evangelinos Misailidis, began to appear as a serial in the Karamanlidika newspaper Anatoly in June 1888. To readers interested in Karamanlidika studies, Misailidis is a very familiar name as an author, journalist, and a publisher who promoted the development and dissemination of works in Karamanlidika. Evangelinos Misailidis, by the way, was himself a Karamanli, born in Kula, Manisa, in 1820. The novel Beyoğlu Sırları is set in late Ottoman Istanbul. However, the author adds retrospective links to the ongoing story via which the readers receive background information on the characters and events, some of which were inspired by historical facts. The multi-layered story begins with the destructive fire which took place in 1870 as a result of the plot hatched by Evie Allen, the female protagonist, who attempts to trick the male character, Andrea Sinoviu, into doubting his wife Hermione's virtue by leading her to a house of ill repute. Because Evie is interested in discarding Hermione and having Sinoviu all to herself. Following the disaster, Sinoviu finds shelter in the residence of the noble, well-respected, and prosperous male protagonist, Georgios Kalimachis, while Hermione ends up being held hostage in another house of ill repute. As the story unfolds, we learn that Georgios Kalimachis used to be Georgios Kallias, a school teacher of moderate means whose wife Efrosini left him and their daughter to run away with her wealthy lover. Because I do not wish to spoil the story for those who have not read the novel, suffice it to say that Kallias, now Kallimachis, is keen on taking revenge on his former wife Hermione and finding their lost daughter in a setting of contrasts, moral versus immoral, poor versus wealthy, noble versus criminal. And the author recounts the story using third-person narration and at times gives the impression of a guide. For example, at one point, we start reading about the formation of the irregular firemen, the Tulumbages, and how they function, etc. The author is openly righteous and criticizes both upper and lower class Greek Orthodox Christians because of their degenerate lifestyles, consumption and entertainment practices, indifference to moral values, and their darkness and malice. While the author portrays two different worlds within the same ethno-religious community, he does not sympathize with one side or the other. Rather, he sides with the virtuous and the conscientious. I would like to stop here and give the word back to Dr. Balta to continue with her talk. And then I will take the floor once more after she finishes.
Okay, Sadam.
Okay.
As Sadat told before, a Greek novel entitled Τα παρά των Βόσπορων Απόκρυφα του Πέρα appeared in the last days of May. That means in 19th May 1988. In Επιθεώρησης, a Greek newspaper of Istanbul. Its author was Epaminondas Kyriakidis, a young, well-known writer and publisher of this newspaper. During our research, I discovered a volume of Epitheorisis in the library of Sismanoglio Megaro. So, via the research on Karamalirika, we found some unknown aspects of the history of the Greek original work. So with Epitheorisis in front of me, I had the opportunity to attest that its Karamanlidika translation was released, as I told before, after a month in Evangelinos Missailidis newspaper Anatoly. For a whole year, from June 1988 to August 1989, it was figured as an installment at the bottom of Anatoly's first page. The synchronic release of the novel Apocrypha του Πέρα in Turkish must be attributed to the profound impact Kyriakidis' novels had on the reading public in Istanbul, so Missailidis hasn't to publish it in his Anatoly. The publication of the story in Kyriakidis' newspaper Epitheorisis was never completed. In all likelihood, this was because the author had scheduled its publication as a book. And indeed, after a year, that means in 1990, it was released as a two-volume book in Istanbul by Kefalidis publishing house. Until recently, nobody had seen this edition because only two copies there are in Greek libraries, one in the library of my institute in Athens, the other one in the library of Aristotle University in Salonika. So most likely for this reason, the mysteries of Pera, the Greek Roman, remained unknown until very recently to Greek philologists. Let's see the fate of Karamanlidika edition. The Karamanlidika edition of novel is known only for its serial form. We did not find it in book form. And I didn't see in the pages of Anatoly an announcement of the forthcoming release of the novel in book form, as was Evangelinos Missailidis, usual practice. Let's see now who was Epaminondas Kyriakidis. Epaminondas Kyriakidis was born in Istanbul in 1861. He schooled at the Fenerokoulou. That means the Fener School of the Nation, Megali του Γένου Σχολή, and studied law in Athens University. As a student in Athens, he published the novels, I give you the translation in English, The Mystery of the Harem and The Jewess. Very successful novels. On his return to Istanbul, he worked as journalist for the newspaper Neologos of Voutiras, in which he published his third novel, Elpiniki. This novel was also a very, very famous novel. He worked for the Greek newspapers of Athens, and in 1893, went to Athens. He worked as journalist in Paris during the First World War, and he died in Athens in 1934. A journalist, writer, and historian, he left behind work of varied content. His name was also linked to great historical studies. His book on the history of the Greek nation during the 19th century is an excellent, a brilliant work. The novel, The Two Hearts, in Greek, οι δύο καρδιές, δύο καρδίε, is a very famous work. It concerns the love story and suicide of the two young lovers, Michael Mimikos, a Greek army officer, and Marie Weber, the nanny of George, son of the King Constantine, first of Greece. Due to its title and content, Beoglou Sirlarou falls into the category of stories known as city mysteries, a type of social novel that first appeared in French. In France, pardon. The success of the book Le Mystère de Paris by Eugène C. produced a wave of imitators worldwide. There is a very rich bibliography on it, on the city mysteries novels. In Greek literature, this genre became popular after the mid of 19th century. In Greek literature, there are many studies on this genre. Lastly, Henri Tonnet, a French academic, published an excellent book on the Greek mysteries novels of the 19th century, where Istanbul occupies a privileged position with its cosmopolitan and multinational air. Senas Sismanoglu and Thanasis Kougoulos, in their recent papers, transferred to the Turkish public the related titles and storylines of the Istanbuliot mysteries novels. This kind of novels realistically portrays poverty, corruption, and criminal behavior in large cities. Istanbul, the empire's capital, became more significant and changed its profile after the Crimean War, and more specifically, after the Russian-Turkish War in 1877-78. Refugees and migrants from areas affected by the wars, many, many disparate people flocked to the city from the Ottoman Empire and European provinces. The presence of foreigners changes the city's appearance and life. High society pair with the Europeans' residence, embassies, balls, luxuries, lifestyle resulted from the new political and social situation that had emerged from the temporary prosperity. There are excellent historical studies which investigate the transformation of Istanbul in this period. Really excellent, which is reflected this transformation also clearly in literary works. Anastasia Tsapanidou, a prof in Komotini University, explored the portrayal of Istanbul in Greek prose of the period 1830-1880, in her thesis, unfortunately, really unfortunately, unpublished yet. Emine Uzun, Aishe Nour Chanel explored the portrait of Istanbul through Tanzimat novels. I don't know if there is something parallel in Armenian prose or Jewish prose, that is, in Latino prose. Excellent comparative works remain to be done in this sector, which will give, at the same time, an idea of the ideological position of each millet in this period of modernization of the Ottoman Empire. The mystery of Constantinople first reveals the corruption among the upper class in Istanbul. Kyriakides too strongly criticizes the extravagance and new habits of the rich society of Pera, a view which also fully embraced by Evangelinos Misailidis. We know Evangelinos Misailidis' ideas on this subject also from several articles published in the Anatoly newspaper. In the same period, the Tanzimat literary production also satirized the ridiculous alla franca attitudes of Turkish society. Close by the hidden side of the high society lies the underground, invisible Istanbul, the low social strata, and the underground, who lives in poor, desolate neighborhoods out of the area of Istanbul, near to the port, near to the forests, etc. The writers of mystery novels give descriptions of dark taverns, bordels, crimes, robberies, producing the image of dangerous city life. Particularly intriguing is the study by Nurgin İleri, which looks at corruption in Istanbul of the late 19th century through the literary works and periodicals such as Tercümani Ahval or Ceride-i Havadis, excellent work. It is important to note also that the writers of mystery novels often embellish their story with events that happened at a certain point in time, historical figures, descriptions of the landscapes. In Beogluşirlare, we read a description of the fire of 1970. It means before, a fire before. The leading character of the novel is a historical figure, the Phanariota Georgios Kalimachis, as noted before, Sada. Evangelinos Misailidis would also add to his Karamanlidika translation, Christakis Zografos, banker and benefactor of the Rum community. All these references above act as ploys on which the writers rely to make their works realistic, to give a sense of authenticity, to provide the reader with a true story. The mystery novel resembles reportage, and it is certainly no accident that most writers of this kind, of this type of novel, were journalists. Some words on translation strategy, followed by Misailidis. I will be very, I will note some briefly some points. His translation is not faithful. The text of the Karamanlidika translation is more limited in extent because Misailidis adopts the strategy of paraphrasing, shortening the dialogues and also the monologues. He does not translate the descriptions of certain buildings, for example, Agia Triada of Taksim Square, or the description of some mahalles, Ta Tavla, Blinemnene. Also missing in the Karamanlidika text, are the legal details of Vakuf properties, etc., because they were either familiar to the Turkophone Rum reading public or did not add anything interest to the novel's story life. So for all this reason, his translation is more short than the original work of Kyriakidis. Second, Michailidis practices a kind of censorship, excluding from his translation any text inappropriate to the moral code of the readers. He therefore chooses to produce a translated text acceptable to the moral code of the Anatolians. The first three chapters miss from Karamanlidika translation, probably because Michailidis discerns that his readers have grown tired from the length of the history. We cannot forget that the aim of all newspapers and periodicals that published serialized novels was to maintain and specifically to swell their reading public, always hoping to increase their circulation, paramecelesi. Michailidis succeeded as a translator in producing the original without the slightest hint of foreigners. His Turkophone reader had the feeling that the text had been created and written in his own language, Anatolian, Turkish Anatolian language. So, in transferring this novel from Greek into the Ottoman language of the era, he added to it elements of the Turkish of Anatolia, words and phrases from the daily life of the Turkophone Romans. It is also worth noting that for reasons linked to the teaching role he had undertaken on his Anatolian compatriots as the publisher of the Karamanlidika books and newspapers, etc., sometimes give some explanation for the Turkish names. He add some notes for the ancient Greek toponyms or Greek ancient names, etc. He became a bridge between the Turkophone, the Grecophone, and the Turkophone Orthodox word. He was, in the same time, publisher and teacher for the Anatolian compatriots. And our principal work in this book was to present exactly this role, to show through the lines of the translation Beoulu Sirları the role of the Evangelinos Michailidis as enlightener of the Anatolians. I finished here and I will be back. I hope that I will be back with some notes. Saddam.
Okay, thank you very much for your talk, Dr. Balta. And now I will talk about the process that
we followed. The
hard work we have done. Of course, I have to keep it brief. I hope we don't bore them with details, but let me start. So why we did this work? I personally believe that we try to exercise, what we try to do, exercise in and achieve in academia is rooted in our love for knowledge. And in the part where we disseminate knowledge, we want to make sure that it does not go astray and reach its destination safe and sound. In this light, now I would like to talk about the experience of transcription at the coalface and how I tried to avoid being a traitor as a translator of a translator. So the texts we worked on came in electronic copies, thanks to people mentioned by Dr. Balta, who made them available to us. The first and most important element of a source is its legibility, which depends on its physical condition and technical quality. There were some missing, torn and illegible parts, and we had to check the series in hard copy with magnifiers, even for one letter. Even when the text is intact, there may still be problems. There may always be typographical errors in print, like there may be today. And even when the text was not erroneous, sometimes we brainstormed our ideas to find the word we thought we read. In such cases, I thought of how the word sounds to my ears, paying attention to where the letters were stressed. And it should also be noted that during the era when the book was written, published, the series were published, the Greek language had more diacritics, more varied accents denoting stress, like the acute, the circumflex, and the grave. There is also the rough breathing that indicates the presence of this H sound before a letter, while the smooth breathing indicates the absence of the sound H. So we had to keep all these in mind while trying to find a word that we thought was problematic. As for the transcription, there are limits to the extent to which the text transfers the contemporary sound of Karamanlidika. Even though one wishes to keep the text as authentic as possible, the Greek letters used in correspondence with Turkish sounds read differently than the Arabic letters. Moreover, the reader may find it exhausting to follow the text if its transcription depends only and simply on vocal elements. In order the text to have harmony, we added footnotes for some words we kept, while we chose to use many words like verbs and subjects as we use them today, still noting how we use them. An important element I should stress in transcription is a substantial familiarity with both Ottoman Turkish and Greek. Even though the novel is in Ottoman Turkish, Karamanlıca, the text has many Greek names and terms, especially regarding religion, education, family, time, and topography. So just to give a few examples, so religious terms, for example, İsa, the Christ, is not referred to as İsa, but Jesus Christos. So, kilise in Turkish, church, is written as ekklesia, used as ekklesia. There are so many examples like ikonostasion, kinonia, lambada, etc. So familiarity with Greek is essential while approaching these terms. And words regarding education, such as daskalos, didaskalos, meaning male teacher, words related with family. For example, Misailidis uses the word exadelphi for a female cousin. So you do not see the word cousin or a kız cousin. I don't remember. I may be mistaken, but I don't remember. So and days and months, like it's not. He doesn't say one Sunday. He says bir Kiryaki günü. Etc. And the months also. Let's say for Shubat, he uses Februarios, etc. We can give so many examples, and I don't want to bore you with details. And also proper names, such as, for example, he doesn't write Bursa, he writes Prusa, and Athenai, not Athena, Bosphor instead of Boazici, But Bosphorus is a Greek word, just like Anatoly. So he uses Anatoly, not Anadolu, but because probably because these words are already Greek. In addition to these, there are combination of Turkish and Greek, such as Notos shark. This was the highlight when I saw this. So Notos shark, Notos meaning south in Greek, and shark is east in Turkey. So there is a combination of two words in two different languages, meaning southeast. This was the highlight for me. And the use of Greek language is not limited to vocabulary, but also grammar. For example, in the vocative, the name Yorgos, becomes Yorie. And if the translator is not familiar with such rules, the transcribed text will lack the subtle touch on the reader and will sound incorrect. We can also give the examples from mythology, like Dr. Balta has mentioned. He sometimes chooses to use both words in both languages, like Zühre, etc. For examples from mythology. And so leaving aside these, I would like to talk about why substantial Ottoman Turkish is necessary for transcription. Why is knowing modern Turkish not good enough? So knowing Turkish, modern Turkish will be enough to understand an already transcribed text with a dictionary probably. But if one were to transcribe a text, she or he has to use the dictionary according to the sounds of the Greek letters. And without knowing Ottoman Turkish, some difficulties will arise when the words you believe you read make no sense to you at first, and you cannot check them in the lexicon, lacking the skills to read the script. In addition, Ottoman Turkish speakers were using terms and phrases we do not use today, or we have come to differently. We have come to use differently, such as nerdüban, meaning merdiven, which is a staircase in English, stairs, staircase. Or he chooses to use, for bread, he says etmek. First, you are surprised, then you check, and you see that etmek used to be ekmek, mean ekmek back in the time. And one more point to add here is the fact that we see in the novel words that entered the Ottoman Turkish language from European languages, especially Italian and French. The ones I remember now are numero, for example. It's not numara as we use it today, or monsieur. He doesn't use the word kirie, I think, for... instead, he chooses to use the word monsieur, which probably was very common among the upper classes back in the late Ottoman capital. Once you believe you have transcribed the text, you realize that the work is just about to begin. So, and now it's time to find many typography mistakes, missing lines, etc. And but more importantly, editing is the part where you realize more important mistakes, such as misunderstanding a word and giving wrong references. I believe these are more important than typography mistakes, definitely. And we did not limit our footnotes to just vocabulary, as we felt the need to give more information on some people, objects, or events in which we believe the reader would be interested. And finally, the people whom we worked, I cannot mention all of their names right now. There are so many people involved in the process while enhancing the text and sharing their thoughts and opinions, correcting the Ottoman Turkish we have forwarded to them. We are truly grateful for their efforts, which made it possible for us to submit the novel to Istos, the publishing company, which we must also thank, who has been doing a great job, a worthwhile contribution to the Ottoman and Greek studies at the same time. People like me studying the late Ottoman capital, I have contributed highly from their publications. Thank you very much. This will be it. And I would be happy to answer questions regarding the preparation of the novel. And we thank you very much for for listening to us. And I would like to thank Anamed and Tarih Vakfı and Dr. Ozil, who on behalf of them kindly invited us to talk today. Thank you very much. So Evangelia Balta, is there anything you would like to add?
Yeah. I have to say, to add some words for Istos Yalnevi, the publishing house of this work. I wish to editorial board of Istos, to scholars as Haris Theodorelis Rigas and Belinsoy brothers, Stephos and Fotis, all my best wishes for their future editions. It is important to continue this legacy of Rum culture of Istanbul via their books. I wish you also, to all of you who participated as audience in this lecture, health and happiness. And I am grateful for your participation. I am very, very grateful, first of all, for the invitation. And I hope that our lecture will be interesting for our audience. Thank you.
We have one question. So the question is, does the most important task belong to the translator then? Sort of, but as I told, I'm speaking for myself, sorry. I will give the word definitely to Dr. Balta. I believe it's both. It's the translator definitely, and then the people in the process who are helping the translator, the other editors, maybe publishers. What do you think, Dr. Balta? Would you like to add?
I didn't understood very well the question. What is the question?
So does the most important task belong to the translator then, while doing this transcription, preparing this publication to the readers? It's okay.
I cannot, the point of this question, what is, this is the technical work of the transcription or the research behind the practical work of the transcription, because behind there is much research for everything mm-hmm. concerning mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. everything we found we find in the lines of the novel. Mm-hmm. That means we had to search for the words, for the names, to search the liaison between the names chosen by the by Kyriakides, and also what parts Evangelinos follows faithful, what kind of lines let out of each translation, etc. There are many kind of problems, many kind of different points to see and to think about it, and also to put the most necessary comments for in this publication, because we didn't put everything in the deep notes. We had to find the most essential, because in the other way, all this edition will be a place of a thesis.
There's only one more.
Clear, I have to say that we try to do that we can do with our knowledge and our experience. There are many, many points which left out. For example, I would like to know, and I didn't have the opportunity to because I don't know this kind of literature, and I didn't note in my introduction what kind of mystery novels were in the Turkish Armenian literature. Mm-hmm. What is the point of view of the Armenian community, Millet? It was the same or different? There are many, many important points of views opened, but this is research. Never stop. Never stopped. We try to do that we can, could do, and let's continue.
There's only one other question.
I cannot accept any other.
Yes, yes. There's a question. I'm sorry.
I wanted to help you.
This is not a question I can help you with. It's about literature. And there are no more questions. And I could kindly give the word to Dr. Ozi.
I have to repeat that if somebody has any question or any issue concerning the Karamanlidis studies, he can write me and he will receive my answer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that will be evangeliabalta.com. So they can contact you there.
I prefer, because I don't open my pages. I am very, very busy, and I am not a young scholar who says how many people. No, excuse me. There is my email address. Okay. I open my email three, four times per day. It's enough. I cannot set my side to find the questions. Okay.
Yes, of course, sure. I mean, you have done so much work for this book as well, and I would like to congratulate you on your hard work on the editing process and for providing us with such depth of information about the literary world of the Karamanlis. So it was a pleasure to have you both here this evening, and I would like to thank you once again for your contribution to the library talks. And I also would like to remind our viewers that the recording of this talk will be available. So it will be shared on the SoundCloud and YouTube channels of Anamet. And I also would like to say that we will be continuing with the library talks in the upcoming months. Next month's talk is scheduled for the 6th of July. The speaker will be Sinan Kaya, who will present on the Suna Karaç Library digital collections, and particularly Hüseyin Hilmi Paşa archive. So until then, I would like to wish everyone a good evening, and thank you again to our speakers.
Thank you.
We thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.